Hello everyone, welcome to our next talk. Angela Cangiolosi is a professor of machine learning and robotics at the University of Manchester. Among his other affiliations, he's also a Turing Fellow at the Alan Turing Institute. So his research interests are in developmental robotics, language grounding, human-robot interaction and trust, and robot companions for health and social care. And his work is at the interface of robotics, AI, and psychology. And before the further ado, I would leave the floor for him to for his talk. Yeah.
Well, thank you for the introduction, Arzu. I'm going to introduce my talk to justify why I do what I do, in the sense, you know, why do I do research in developmental robotics? And now this is linked to interdisciplinary approaches. And to do this, you will see I'm going to give you a bit history of my training and my discipline hopping, if you want. And I'm doing this because the audience includes PhD students from different disciplines. And I think it will help them to reflect that the career pathways really change according to the way you shape it and to opportunities. And Perseo, of course, it's a really unique opportunity to do this. So what do I do in terms of research? I have two main interests. The first one is more technical. I would like to do research in developing new scientific insights and new technological methods to design robots, in particular to design the capability to communicate with humans, understanding the words that they use. Concrete words, abstract words, we are going to look at this in detail during the talk. On the other hand, part of my research, I say normally not a minority, maybe 20% of my time, I like to use these models to create realistic or plausible cognitive models that, for example, simulate the way people, or in my case, children, develop their linguistic skills. So we want to use insights from computational models to better understand also human and natural cognition. So the second part of my interest has to do with psychology and neuroscience. The first part instead more related to the discipline of computer science, AI, robotics, which is, you know, the disciplines at the department where I belong to primarily. But to do this, I like to make students reflect on the fact that the career and the choices that we make sometimes depend on many factors. Some we choose them, we choose what to study, others are opportunities. So to do this, I like to play like a word pun on the concept of journey. So I'm going to show you first my geographical journey and my interdisciplinary journey. So I come from this beautiful place called Sicily. This is Copello, a seaside place near where I live. Then I moved when I was 18, 19 for university in Rome. And then I moved further up north. You can see the trajectory from Sicily, south of Italy, middle Italy, north of Italy, Genoa. And while I was in Genoa, I decided to spend a year in San Diego. So I was not anymore towards the north, but more sideways. And then I decided to continue the north path. So I went to this south of England, which is north of, compared to Italy, which is Plymouth and Devon. This is where I spent 21 years. And I'll introduce the move to further north in the northwest of England in a moment to Manchester. So what does this mean in terms of interdisciplinary journey? What did I do? How did I change what I was studying, what I was specializing on? So I started studying philosophy, Latin and Greek languages, humanities, we say Liceo Classico in Sicily. So the temple that you see there is actually near my hometown. It's a Greek temple. We were a Greek colony once. Then I studied in Rome, psychology, experimental psychology, in particular doing project on human-computer interaction, but also did some animal experiments with perception in mice. And then for my PhD, I did this between Genoa and San Diego, and I started to move towards AI for cognitive modeling. This is what I did for my PhD, language evolution and language grounding. And then when I moved to Plymouth, I further extended my technical background by doing work with robots, so moving towards robotics. For robotics here, we mean the software side of robotics, the AI side of robotics. So I don't build robots, but I rather use ready-made robots like the iCap to program them to behave like with human-like intelligence, human-inspired intelligence. And then more recently, this was now about 3.5 years ago, I moved further north, you see the trend. So maybe next time I give you a talk, I might be, I don't know, in Finland, if I continue to go in this direction. And here, I continue to do my work on robotics with a further specialization in machine learning, which really means modern AI, if you want. The reason I'm giving you this introduction is to make you reflect that you can change your career pathway. And also, and I would say PhD is the moment for me in which the change from psychology to computer science became more evident. So it's an opportunity for the students doing ESR PhDs, but also the external participants. And of course, you know, there are then opportunities that come from collaboration grants and so on. But now let's go back to my two interests and let's see how you will see in every slide of my talk, how my philosophy training when I was a high school student, my psychology training at university permeates, you know, it interacts with whatever I do in terms of cognitive robotics. So let's start with philosophy, a philosophy of cognitive science actually. So Quine, 1960, proposes the concept of language indeterminacy, meaning it's very hard, almost impossible, to exactly determine the meaning of a word. It's just an exploration process. And so he uses the example of a thought experiment. Let's assume we are anthropologists, linguists. We want to understand the new language, translate this new language. We go into the Amazon, new tribe. They never interacted with us, Western people. We have to give meanings to words. And one sound, one word that I hear as an anthropologist studying this new language is the word gavagai. This is an example that Quine uses. So if I say gavagai to you guys, you are muted, so I cannot really do it with you, but we will do an exercise in the chat in a moment. If I ask you, what's the meaning of gavagai? Actually, we can do this with a chat, can't we? Can you please write in the chat, what do you think is the possible meaning of gavagai? Just be aware, there is no correct answer to this, okay? This is the whole point of Quine. So what are possible meanings? Assuming the organizers, are people allowed to send a message to everybody in the chat? So I need volunteers from the Perseo. You know me, I know you, very good. Gone, very good. Are you hungry? Very good. Are there possible meanings? Take it, excellent, excellent. That's what I wanted. I wanted the variety. I also wanted the word rabbit that no one is proposing, that doesn't matter. So supposedly, rabbit is the first hypothesis we should make, although in this case, the girl has a big prominence, because in child psychology, there is a bias towards shape. So if I see a big shape, a big object in the main scene, I will make an hypothesis as a child, my first, second year of age, that the word might have to do with the shape, in this case, would be the rabbit or the girl. But all your meanings were excellent, because all the meanings are right until we do something called cross-situational learning. So I'm going to say gavagai again, but now when I see this screen, so gavagai. So the hypothesis that this had to do with cute, very good. So it changed, grass, very good. Grass is most common between the two. Dog or better animal is common between the two, pet, right? So we are refining our hypothesis. Why doing, we say in psychology, cross-situational learning, which is exactly what we did when we were learning, if we were, you know, for those who were born in an English-speaking country, when we heard the word grass, green, rabbit, dog, right? We were comparing across situations. But we don't really need to do thought experiment or child psychology experiments. I do robotics, so how am I going to teach a robot the concept of rabbit, green, beautiful, cute, right? You are using abstract words. So some are very concrete in the sense, you know, a dog is a dog with specific features. The grass and green are relatively common, let's say, but other features are very different, like, you know, cute, hungry. How do we know it's hungry? What do we represent the concept of hungry? You will see my talk examples of hungry, the use of abstract and concrete words. So let's go now back to state of the art in language learning in technology and robots. So nowadays there are good solutions, Alexa, Siri. You can pre-program a machine with a full dictionary. You give it the full dictionary, the full list of words, and magic, you get a dialogue, which is true if we consider the dialogue meaningless. If I have an Alexa and I ask Alexa, can you make me a cup of coffee? Alexa will say, yes, the procedure or the recipe to do this is step one, step two, step three. So Alexa will not do it for me, will give me a recipe. If I have a robot in my home, when I ask the question, can you make him a cup of tea? I expect a pragmatic compliance, meaning I would like the robot to do what I, you know, what is my, achieve my goal by making the robot itself my cup of coffee, meaning understanding the procedure, the meaning of cup, some sugar, what some, is some sugar 2 spoons, 1 spoon, this is related again to the context of the use of words. So this is not good, you know, having an Alexa, it's not even possible to link an Alexa to a robot and hope that things will work, because it's hard to define the definitions of this complex word, especially abstract words. So let's go in the mind of Alexa, and we ask Alexa, let's say there is an Alexa that talks to a robot, or a robot that uses Alexa to handle the dialogue. So I said to Alexa, to the robot using Alexa, what's the meaning of push? The robot, Alexa, using a dictionary, like the Webster dictionary, will tell me, I have no problem, because I can find an entry in my dictionary that says that push means to press forcefully against, to move, which is okay, you know, you're doing well. You're giving me meaningful answers at the moment, but let's see if this keeps going. So, and then I ask to define a word within the definition, like force. So what's the definition of force? Alexa, the robot using Alexa, tells me force is energy or strength. And what's energy then? Energy is the strength of force. You see where the problem starts to happen. A word defines another word, which then defines the previous word. Merry-go-round, Harnad calls it. Basically, we are go back to where we were. Words, linked to words, linked to words. But remember, I need the robot to push an object. I need the robot to sense the force being applied to its joints, you know, its motors, in the arm, let's say, in the shoulder, to make sure it does the pushing properly. So relying on Alexa is not good. In fact, to stay within philosophy of science and AI, John Searle proposed another thought experiment, the Chinese Room Experiment. And there is a nice video from David Eagleman, it's part of the documentary, that describes what we mean for Chinese Room Experiments. This is a documentary that includes 2 parts in the last episode on language, on artificial brains. One is on the Chinese Room, and then it follows up with a video of the experiments with our robot. So let's look at this video to know what this is.
In the 1980s, the philosopher John Searle was chewing on this problem, and he came up with a thought experiment that gets right at the heart of it. And he called this the Chinese Room.
The experiment goes like this. I'm locked in a room. Outside, there's someone who only communicates in Chinese. She writes out some questions and then posts those to me in the room.
Now, I don't speak Chinese, but I do have these books, and they give me instructions on exactly what to do with these symbols. So I look in the book, and if I can find a match to the symbols, then the book tells me exactly how to respond. So I can look up this response. That matches. So now I can post this as the reply to the message I received.
When our Chinese speaker receives the message, it makes perfect sense to her.
您最喜欢哪一本书？哪里是中国的首都？你梦里梦到什么？
As far as she's concerned, we're having a conversation in her language.
I like this thought from David Eagleman. As far as she's concerned, we are having a conversation. So if I'm talking to Alexa, as far as I'm concerned, we are having a conversation, right? So let's see if this is true, because I'm going now to run with you a Chinese Room experiment. We use the chat again. I'm going to ask you questions, not in Chinese, because Chinese is very hard for us Western people, right? So let's use another version. I hope no one, this is a real language. I will tell you which language this is in a moment. So if this is your language, please don't cheat. Don't give me the answers just because you know the language. But all the others, I hope you don't know the language. And I'm going to ask you a question. In particular, actually, we have 2 groups here. If your surname is A2L, starts A2L, you have to answer the question, Mita Sioda Tito. This is my question. I would like you to answer in the chat, the answer. So you give me the answer. The other group, M to Z, will answer the question, Quinkanal Kakana. So you can do this. Remember, David Eagleman had a book, we call the reply rule book. On one side, you have the questions. On the other side, you have the answer. But here I use variable x, a, b, c to make it a bit trickier. Otherwise, it's too obvious. So the question that for a group, sorry, group one is Minka Sioda Titto. Other group is Queen Kamal Kakana. So can you please do this exercise? Now I'm going to stop talking for 2 minutes. And then I ask you to put in the answer in the chat is saying Q1, Q2. Okay. So let's try to do it. As soon as you can guess the answer, please type Q1 and your answer, or type Q2 and your answer. And I'm going to explain this. Remember, there is no wrong answer, meaning it's a thought experiment and so on. So some of you are very fast. Oh my goodness. Okay, so let's see if I can have more answers, please. So I'm going to take one example. One person says, Melania, if you don't mind me using you, your answer. So question one, Mitto Sioda Titto. The answer is Titto Sioda Muna. Let's see what she did. Mita Sioda Titto, Mita Sioda Titto, right? We are in the last question. Look at the pointer here. X is Titto. So what? How do we answer? X, Titto, sorry, Titto, very good. Sioda is there. C, we need to find something about C. So what do? We go to Titto in the dictionary, we go to Sioda, and we see Muna, right? They are next to each other. There's a comma that separates them. So likely, the answer is Mito, Titto, Sioda, Muna. Let's see, Titto, Sioda, Nalka, Titto, Sioda, Muna. There it is. So Imene, you took it right, Titto, Sioda, Mina, Mita, Muna. Okay, but you can get the answer, the feeling. So Quinca Nalca Cana is the second question. Answer is, sorry, Quinca Nalca Cana, answer Cana Nalca. And then we go to Cana, we go to Nalca, and we find Palion, right? So that's how we do it. But the whole point of this, so well done to all of you. The whole point of this is, these are the correct answers, if you can compare yours. The whole point is that we are playing, we are like parrots, right? We are parroting, we are bubbling. This is bubbling, it's not meaningless. We are talking to Alexa, Alexa doesn't understand the word, and it's the same, exactly the same here. So we demonstrated that we can have a conversation in a language without understanding a word. But if we have a robot that has to make me this cup of coffee, I'm reading the robot to understand words. For example, what's Titto? Can you please use the chat again to type the meaning of Titto? What's the possible meaning of Titto? It's like Gava guy. You, girl, very good. This is easy, it's girl. Okay, noun, that's fair enough. Everything. Remember, cross-situational learning, I should show you more examples if you were to do this. Then second meaning, what's tat is hard, ignore tat. What's kana? Kana is easy. Kana is... is kana, what's kana? The third word, chicken, very good. Muna is egg and so on. Up to here, it's seeds is semen, right? Now let's try to do something a bit harder. What's palion, if I show you this? Sorry, what's vahan first? Can somebody type the meaning of, the possible meanings of vahan? There is more than one. Eggs, plural, triple, very good. Three triples, excellent. Oh my goodness, you're so good. Very good. Omelette, why not? I like this. Multiple. Yes, I can make an omelette with three. Now, can somebody refine the meaning, cross-situation learning, of vahan? What's vahan? So the omelette person, I'm sorry, Arzu, the omelette is gone because you can't really do an omelette with seeds unless you want to do it. So it's food, what else is there? Group, very good, the set, diverse, very good. It's not three anymore. Okay, very good. What's the meaning of vahan again, now that you do cross-situation learning? Vahan, refine it, please. So, no, many is palion, vahan is small, few, very good. Okay, so you are doing cross-situational learning. And finally, excellent group of students. What's the meaning of sioda? Sioda? slice, why not? Eating, why not? Dinner, eat, very good, food. Now, what's the meaning of Sioda now?
Oh.
Can you write the meaning after you're seeing this video? Digesting or eating, basically it's the action, right? So I'm making you reflect with this game. First, I'm making you sure that you're paying attention after lunch, but also I'm making you reflect to the fact that there are easy words, concrete words. An egg always has the same shape, maybe two different colors, small variation of size, but the perceptual communality for a concrete word is quite strong. Then there are abstract words like quantifiers, quantities, which become very hard to represent visually. Actually, you need to represent the contracts, right, to give it a meaning. And then there are other words like actions or verbs that require a sequence of frames, requires an action. All this is to tell you that we are now going to present a series of experiments where we teach robots to learn concrete words, abstract words, and nouns for actions. Just out of curiosity, this is Sicilian dialect. So when I do a talk where there aren't many Italians, but here we have too many Italians with the coordination in Naples and so on. So I didn't run my Sicilian dialect. So I talk to you in my dialect, and I like to hear people responding in Sicilian without understanding a word of what they say. Now let's go back to science. Or let's go back to our approach and how we achieve some results. So we don't want to pre-program our robots with dictionaries because these things don't work. Meanings don't work this way. Meanings have to be acquired with experience, perceptual experience, motor experience if you're eating. So what insights can we have from child psychology? Because we have been referring to how children do cross-situational learning. First, giving the full dictionary at the beginning is not right. Maybe being slow, it's good. Children at 18 months of age, 1.5 years of age, they probably know 10 to 20 words, very few. And it takes a while for them to go to a stage where it's called fast mapping, which is I learn the mapping between sound and vision, image and object, vision of an object and the sound, the name, very fast, in later stages, towards the second year of age, 24 months. Children use their body, you know, they learn language by practically interacting with the environment. You will see an experiment in a moment where this is demonstrated. The brain is very modular. We have vision here, the back, we have motor control here, we have auditory processing on the other side, but people have demonstrated the brain is co-activated. All these different areas are co-activated when you perform a linguistic task. Meaning, when there is a sound, a word, I can think of the sound, I can think of the meaning, I can think of the motor. If it's eating, I can simulate the action in my mind, in my brain. And then children learn in a social context. So children have developed at some stage something called theory of mind. The knowledge that other people, other children, other parents have a mind of their own, their mental states, they have desires, they have goals that they want to achieve and so on. And we will see this in examples again. So what's the field in which I'm working? This is called developmental robotics, which is part of the wider field of cognitive robotics. So I sit on the top here in the sense I'm the child playing with the keyboard. I'm a computer scientist now, not a psychologist anymore, professionally speaking. We work with roboticists, we build robots, linguists who understand the theory of language, psychologists, cognitive psychologists, child psychologists. We work a lot with them, neuroscientists, and also in language evolution, there is interest in ethology and how animals can learn sign language or visual language or spoken language. This was summarized a few years ago in a book that I wrote with Matthew Schlesinger, a psychologist. And now we are going to focus instead on practical examples for you to get a feeling of what it means to do research in robotics inspired by child psychology. We say embodied language learning because body embodiment with robots is at the center of it. So what we do, we study, you know, the main milestones, the main mechanisms well established in child development. First year is about phonetics. We learn the sound of a language. Second year, we learn to categorize things into classes, bananas, apples, fruit. Bananas can be only yellow, have a specific shape. Apples can be same shape, round, all the apples, but the color can differ. Third year of age is more about understanding sentences, two, three words in a sentence. And the way we do this is by working very closely with baby labs. These are child psychology labs. We We have done this with Linda Smith in Indiana, Jessica Horst in Sussex, Karen Floch in Plymouth, Katie Toomey, she's now a colleague in Manchester, and I'm collaborating a lot with Marchetti's group in Milan Cattolica University. So let's see how we collaborate with them. First, we analyze their study. Sorry, the video is not starting. Let me try this. Let's see if I can start the video, yeah? This is an experiment done by Smith and Samuelson a few years ago. This is to demonstrate that the way the child moves her body towards the left and right part of the screen identifies a strategy to later acquire the name of the words when the objects being named are not visible at the same time.
Look at that.
So in a moment, which is now, the experimenter is naming the object when the object is not visible, right?
Oh, look at that.
So let the child play with the two objects again. And in a moment, we do a test.
Can you find me the mode?
Basically, you put them in the middle. Let's check if the child knows which object is which. So this is the experiment, left, right. Step 5, you hide the object. You make sure the child's body is paying attention, is posturally moved towards, let's say, our left. You say the name and then you show the object in the middle. 73% of children, the majority, can actually understand the meaning of words, or meaning they know that the object name refers to the one always shown on the left. If we randomly place the two objects in the two positions, of course, not there is a random behavior, chance behavior, 46%. We used this strategy a few years ago to start teaching our ICAP to speak. Tony Morse, my collaborator, is going to show you two strategies. First is the fast mapping. I see, I hear at the same time, I learn, easy. Second is the MODI. I show you something, I hide it, I make sure you look at the same location. You will see Tony moving his fingers to make sure the robot looks at things and move. So same position, and then you say the name.
So this is the ICAP robot, and today we're going to teach it the names of some objects. A truck and a ball. So let's see how it
works.
So fast mapping, you see the robot can learn the association between the two names, regardless of the location or the position.
So when children learn the names of objects, those objects.
Now is the MODI experiment.
This
is a postural memory for learning words. You see the vision on top, the camera of the robot, some processing. So look at Tony's hands. Tony's hands move, the fingers, and the robot looks at the same location.
Yeah, no.
And you can see that the robot is actually learning easily these words. Okay? I hope you like the demonstration and I'm convincing you that you need embodied experience to learn words, or at least to learn the meaning of words. Remember, it's all about meanings. What's behind this? For those of you who come from a technical background, there is an AI machine learning architecture. We call it AI architecture. There are some cone maps or self-organizing maps. Now you can use a deep learning classifier that recognize color, category, shape, category. The body is represented as a map of your body. If I'm moving my body towards the left, the right, the center, this is represented in this topographic map. Speech to understand the words, and then there is a bit of machinery to allow the robot to look at things and move so you can get its attention. These are examples how our data with robot experiments matches the data of children experiments. So this is the experiment at the beginning, same location, switch position. What matters here is that the last two columns, the last two pairs of columns, where the data on child experiments were collected after we had predicted that there would have been an above chance and below chance performance. This is if you add the complexity of what we do. Okay, so I don't go into the details here. It's more to tell you what the way we design our models allows us, as I said at the beginning, to build a model which is a plausible model of cognitive mechanisms, which then we can use to predict better human cognition, child learning, child language learning mechanisms. Second set of experiments, I'm skipping the videos here. We have a robot that performs actions. So we are giving names to actions like lift, push. The famous push is not a definition anymore. It's a motor demonstration. And then the robot can respond to this. We use recurrent deep learning architecture, which is the state of the art at the moment. I'd like to go next to show you the concept of open-ended cumulative learning. In developmental robotics, we dream of sending our robot to kindergarten before we go to work. It's like a child. You bring the child to kindergarten, to nursery school, you go to work, you come back, pick them up, they come home and say, what did you learn today? So let's see what will happen in this virtual kindergarten.
Open-ended because learning builds a cumulative, it builds on the previous experience.
This is a box. Ouch. What is this? Ouch. Where is
so this
box?
Is fast mapping. I see, I hear, at the same time, I learn to associate.
Where is the state?
This is called mutual exclusivity. If I know the name of an object, I see a new object, and I hear a new sound, I associate
box?
Them by default, by exclusivity. Now another mechanism, two words, sentences with two words. Let's say adjective and noun.
Look at the red cup. What is this? Red cup.
Now we generalize our knowledge.
What is this?
We only know the cup. Name, cup, we don't know the color, right? Now we only know the color. Name,
what is this?
We don't know the shape.
Red.
And then you can do things a bit more complex. Let's learn two new words. Color and
look
shape. Now. And now mutual exclusivity using color.
Where is the purple counter?
So by exclusivity, I know green, it must be purple, by also learning another word, carton, right? So all this shows that we can teach a robot in a cumulative way, building on one skill on another, more complex words and structures and so on. And if you go back to my Chinese room experiment, remember Palion and Vahan, few, many. So how can we teach a robot the concept of quantifiers? How can we teach a robot the concept of one, two, three, one egg, one girl, one room, one world, one group, nothing perceptually there, which is common? How do we do this? So if I ask you the question, you should answer, how do we teach children to count? Is by exploiting motor strategies, right? Finger counting, pointing. You point when you do this and so on. That's how we are going to use the same mechanisms, insights from child psychology for our robots. So we have done work on finger counting, on gesturing, and then other abstract words like use a hammer, use an idea, make a cake, or make a plan in robotics and so on. Let's look at the example of counting. This is work done by Alessandro when he was a young postdoc. Now he's a full professor. Well, once he was a young postdoc. And we are teaching the robot to count with its fingers and then also to do simple additions. But let's compare the two charts on the left here. The first one is for a robot, a group of robots who has been trained to perform finger counting. One, two, three, four. And let's look at the similarity here. This is a cluster diagram that looks at similarity. You can see one and two, two and three are very similar, meaning the branching is low, which is makes sense, right? Number one is similar to number two, numerically speaking. Number one is very different from number nine and 10. Look, I go up and then I go down, very different, which is nice. Let's look instead at the mind, if you want, the neural network of a robot which only learned to babble like Alexa, one, two, three, four, five, without every finger. So what would an Alexa without fingers think or numbers? Let's analyze the similarity. Seven and six are similar, very good. Seven and six are numerically similar. So well done, Alexa. What about two and 10? Two and 10 are more similar than 10 and nine. Why? Because Alexa is a speech system. So two, 10, 10, right? Alexa discovered that 2 and 10 have the same sound. So even 7 and 6 are actually similar because of sound similarity, not because of numerical similarity, right? This is to say, without giving Alexa a finger, or by asking iGAP to use its fingers, we are forcing the robot to think, if you allow me to use the word think in a cautious way, to represent numbers, words, into a similarity because one comes next to two, two is next to three, one is very far from five in the sequence. And then a common student of Alessandro and me, Leszek Pecina, did a study where he added also the word, the gesturing in addition to counting. Again, we compare child psychology experiments where there is a child that sits without pointing, puppet that points, or the child which points at itself, and you can see the performance improvement in the robot and in the children, of course. So I have another 5 minutes now to look at the final aspects of language development in robots, which is social aspects theory of mind. But let's summarize to say that we have demonstrated that philosophical insights on the indeterminacy of language meaning the discovery. It's a complex problem. It requires experience in the world, including embodied experience. Even in embodied experience, you can use your body, fingers, to represent abstract concepts. And our studies demonstrate that this is possible. So our robots understand, between quotes, not that they are aware of understanding, they demonstrate a behavior which corresponds to features of the meaning. So one and two and three are numbers. Features of the numbers is the order, and the robot is capable of representing this order, accounting objects, and so on. But we said at the beginning that language learning, cognition, is also social cognition. So we learn in a world where we depend on each other, including we trust some people, we don't trust others. Alessandra, before me, talked about trust, right? The importance of trust. So we are linking theory of mind with trust between people and robots. This is part of a US-funded project, but now we also have a UK-funded project on transport autonomous systems. And I'm going to focus only one study to give you an idea how we do research in the field. Theory of mind, the capability to attribute mental states, beliefs, goals to another person, develops over time, meaning earlier in development, 3-4 years of age, children don't show theory of mind capabilities. Later, towards 6 to 9 years of age, they demonstrate that they understand that people have their own opinions, their own understanding of the world. How do they test this in children? It's the Sully-Ann task or false belief task. It's a cartoon. So first you show the scene where Sully on the left and Ann on the right, on our right, are there next to two containers. So Sully hides the toy into the first container. She goes away. The naughty Ann swaps the location of the object of Sally's toy when Sally's away, and then you ask the child in a test situation, where will Sally look for her toy when she returns? If you are earlier in development, children will say the object will be here in the box on the right, because that's where they saw it. Instead, if they are later in development, they know that Sally was away when the object was being swapped. So they know that Sally thinks that the object is in the left position. That's what they will say. This is one of the methods to demonstrate this. We did the same with our robots using a paper robot here. Three stages to simulate a task similar to the false belief using stickers left and right.
Please look at me. Can you suggest me the location and the sticker, left or right?
So first you play a game with the person to build the theory of mind or the reliability of this person's, you know, game strategy. Different person, this is a consistent helper person. The label on the top is for us. The robot doesn't know the label. The robot determines the theory of mind of the person using this mechanism, meaning the actual interaction. Now you can use your previously learned theory of mind, which is a machine learning mechanism shown on the right.
I was right not to trust you. I've never seen you before. I'll call you informer too.
So you can even map your previous knowledge to new people with a bias on your experience. So on the...
I didn't trust you, but I was wrong. Sorry.
And finally, explainable AI, belief estimation.
Now again, informer one. I know the sticker is on the left. I also believe you would point left to me.
So what the robot did in the final stage is very important. The robot reads its internal states to explain to the person why it is making specific choices. This is a fundamental development in ethical AI, in which we have expertise, of course, in our groups here, which means that we must empower our robots to make sure that they can explain to us what they do, why they do it, how they do it, rather than having a full black box without control. So let me summarize. This is a collaboration with Antonio Kella's group, University of Palermo. So how and when can we use this research? This can be used in research with people, all the robots in all the people home. This is something that we did together with Sant'Anna, Paolo Dario's biorobotics group in Sant'Anna, previous project. We can do this in human-robot collaboration with cobots. Cobots, collaborative robots, are robots that in a factory work with people to build cars and make things. These have been used by my colleague Tony Belpame. You saw the talk this morning for research on human-robot interaction, where you can have speech interfaces partially based on our research. And then, of course, you can also do, this is previous work I did, the evolutionary communication. You can have many agents that learn, discover a way to talk to each other to perform a joint task. Let's go now back to the final slide to reflect on what has been a good journey. Remember this interdisciplinary journey. What have we learned? What do we believe is positive and what needs to be done, of course? What have we learned? First, we believe that by using these approaches, especially the last on theory of mind and trust, we are building human-centered AI systems, AI and robotic systems, where robots give explanations, robots are built by people, for people, and so on. Second, big part of my talk, we have an embodiment cue in most of the behaviors. Even in abstract thinking, you wouldn't imagine you need motor behavior, motor strategy, but you actually do need them. Then you can look at multiple developmental phenomena. You saw that we have mutual exclusivity, fast mapping, multi-setup, multi-word in the same open-ended scenario. And we briefly touched on the fact that if what we build is constrained on our known mechanisms or human development, including embodiment strategies, then we can have a nice match between our robotics data and child psychology data, including making predictions in some cases. So these are the positives. What needs to be done? What are the open challenges? What are some of the open challenges? One is to make it work with larger, more realistic scenarios and number of words. In my research, we stop at 10, 20 words. We use hundreds or thousands of words. So can our methods scale up to do this? I already mentioned explainable AI, which is very relevant. We're doing more research on this. And then, of course, I mentioned the applications. In particular, what we like to do, which is part of the summer school, is to make sure that robots, when interacting with people, they adapt to the personal needs, personal requirements. Again, human-centered AI. So a robot learns the meaning of a word in interaction with different people. So language is relative to the context in which it is being used.